Thanks, Bakker, the naturopath from New Zealand. Thanks for coming back. Why do SIBO patients tend to have more acid reflux, more GERD, you know, gastroesophageal reflux disease, than non-SIBO patients? I've certainly noticed a connection here. Not all people with small intestinal bowel overgrowth issues will experience reflux disease, but many, many people do. Dr. Norman Robillard, PhD, who I hold in very high admiration for his digestive work, has a theory, and it's an excellent theory which I totally endorse from where I'm sitting, from my experience, that what happens in the small bowel, okay, if you've got bacteria sitting there right at the top part of the duodenum, they're going to be producing gases, aren't they? Okay, you're going to get an inappropriate fermentation, a dysbiosis fermentation. I've always called SIBO dysbiosis because that's what we used to call it, you know, poor bacteria. But now we know that the small bowel, particularly the upper regions, or a lot of these bacteria can really thrive. Now, what the hell, how could this be connected with stomach acid? Well, if they produce gases, when you think about it, they could be putting pressure on the stomach and forcing acid up rather than down, which can make it come more up in the upper regions. And eventually, Les, poor Uncle Les, the lower esophageal sphincter that sits on top of the stomach, will eventually become weaker and weaker and open, and you'll get reflux disease. So, but what about drugs? Aren't they any good? Why don't we just recommend a proton pump inhibitor or, you know, Nexium or some crap like that? Well, I totally agree with Dr. Robillard that these are a really dumb thing to do, because when you take acid-blocking drugs, unfortunately, you're going to create an environment in the stomach lower down into the small bowel where, you know, it's more conducive for the growth of these small bacteria. So, in fact, you're shooting yourself in the foot. If you've got SIBO, I'm trying to say, is, and you take a drug for stomach acid problem, you could make the SIBO worse, okay? So instead, Robillard, in fact, is not really agreeing with FODMAPs in that case, who would encourage people to eat, you know, like resistant starches, like sort of semi-raw bananas and corn and things like that. And I agree with Robillard, but I don't have specific recommendations for food, because for where I'm sitting, I see too many people have got variables. I don't like bringing out cookie-cutter diet sheets, you know, that say give to 1,000 people and suits everybody. So many people will benefit from some foods that really aggravate the hell out of others. So cases have to be taken on their individual merits. There are so many variables with patient. The best approach for SIBO and for GERD is the individual approach, where the patient is seen as a complete blank white sheet of paper separate from any other patient. And that's how it should be in medicine. People shouldn't be treated, you know, like paint by numbers. It just doesn't work like that, folks. So if you are going to see a practitioner, don't come to me, because, you know, my clinic, again, I'll say it is finished end of November. You need to find someone who can offer you a holistic approach for this kind of a problem, all right? So I can definitely see a connection with esophageal reflux disease and small intestinal bowel overgrowth. So now you're saying, all right, mate, you've given us the problem. Now give us the solution. Well, the solution is to work on the SIBO, okay? Try and get rid of these bad bacteria in the small intestine. Have a look at a product that's going to work, not just for bacteria, but for fungal, okay? Because don't forget, we've spoken about SIFO, small intestinal fungal overgrowth, all right? So when you're going to take a supplement, make sure that it will hit bacteria and fungus at the same time. You need a broad spectrum product that's going to do that. I'm not going to be banging drums or blowing whistles or trying to promote myself, but the CanXida Remove I designed, I think it was in 2013, was designed for SIFO and SIBO, all right? So taking something, don't have to take my pills, I mean, you can take anyone's product, but try and target the issue you've got with the SIBO, okay, as well as work on the diet and lifestyle to reduce the GERD problem that you've got, the reflux disease. And we've spoken about that in the previous video I did. Please watch the video, The Real Cause of Acid Reflux and How to Get Rid of It. I think it's a 14-minute video. I really like you to watch that video if you haven't seen it. In fact, that video should be seen ideally before this one, all right? Then you'll understand the concepts of what I'm trying to say about reflux disease. If you've had reflux disease a while and then you develop more bowel issues, get a stool test done. Please go and get a comprehensive stool analysis done to find out what you've got lurking inside your gut. Many people say to me, waste of time. I want to get a breath test, you know. I agree. Get a breath test, a proper one, okay, by a reputable company, and get a comprehensive stool analysis. Get all the facts. Try and find out what the heck is going on. And if you really want to do a proper job, Get some blood counts done too. Kidney function, liver function, you know, things like that. Smart idea. But if you get a bit of testing done, you can often pinpoint some key issues, and generally you'll find a bacteria sitting there that needs nuking, a bacteria or a fungus. So make sure that you go on a proper program that's going to last 4 to 6 weeks to clear this mess up. Wait a few weeks, treat again if so need be, and then down the track, retest to see what's going on, right? But to go on medications for blocking acid, it's not a good idea, all right? It's not a good idea. Thanks for tuning in. Don't forget to click on the link if you want my free Candida report. Thank you.